Okay. Bear with me a moment. I'm just putting some things on our Facebook page. Okay, good morning, everybody. Sorry, I've got two more links to post in the Facebook page for you. There. Okay, sorry about the whoops. Now I put the wrong. No, that was the right chapter. There we go again. Okay, sorry for that brief confusion. Good morning, everybody. So today we're going to get into what for many people is the quintessential, the most enjoyable of the communication technologies to look at. Movies. And since we're running a little bit late, I'll get right into it. So like our other communication arenas, technologies, industries, we'll start by talking a little bit about some of the precursors, some of the technologies that are the foundation on which film technology was initially developed. People have been playing with light and images for quite some time, and we'll go back to the 1600s, the 17th century, when what are called magic lanterns were a popular form of entertainment. These were lanterns that used some light to display an image, which was essentially using shadows as a form of showing an image to somebody. Still photography was another technology on which film was developed. Still photography came about in the early 1800s. Was a technology that developed over time. Initially, film technology involved chemical images that were placed on glass. When the technology developed and flexible film could be used to hold an image, that brought us closer to the technologies necessary for film. There's an object called a phonetoscope. This is a toy. It's a toy with spinning discs that produce the illusion of moving images. And you may have seen these at some point. I'm sure you're all familiar with a phenomenon. You may not know the name of it, but there's a phenomenon called persistence of vision, which basically means our brains will process the things that we see and try to make connections between them. Our brains are always trying to make sense of the world around us. And this tendency of the brain is one reason, the reason that's been identified, that when we see a series of images that are similar but not quite the same, we interpret those images, that series of separate images that are similar but not quite the same, as one image in motion, as one object in motion. Another technology, the zoetrope. I've seen the zoetrope in carnivals, not recently, but some time ago. The difference between the zoetrope and the phonetoscope was a little disc that you could kind of hold and watch. And the zoetrope is more like a cylinder with a big cylinder with little slots in it and pictures. And as you spin it, you look through a slot and you see the images going past, and it looks like something in motion. Production of paper photo negatives and glass slides was something that allowed projection of images. There's also something called the intermittent mechanism. This was something that was developed for sewing machines, a mechanical mechanism, I guess is the best way to call it. It would allow for sewing machines to insert a needle with a thread, pull it out, and tie the thread off, so that a machine could effectively sew. This technology was something that early film technology developed, adapted to move film through a projector quickly and smoothly, so that we could project light through it and project an image on a screen. 1878. Edward Muybridge was he was experimenting with photographic technology, and he made a bet with somebody about whether a horse's legs are ever completely off the ground when it's running. And so what he did was he set up a series of still cameras with tripwires and ran a horse past all the cameras, so that as the horse ran, each camera took an individual photo. Then he could, using this evidence, he could show that actually when the horse was galloping, there was a point at which all of its legs were off the ground. So photography, in this sense, photography, early photography and early film weren't so much developing necessarily just for entertainment. Early photography and early film were novelties that were used sometimes for scientific purposes to provide evidence for something, but they were also novelties that were entertainments in and of themselves, and were not, early film wasn't really about storytelling. We think of film now, we think of the things that we do with film. For the most part, what we do culturally with film now is tell stories, and these may be things like fictional stories or stories to be interpreted. The earliest film, even film that was commercially exhibited, wasn't, at least from our perspective, from the modern perspective, wasn't necessarily so much about telling a story. It was oftentimes about just showing an image of something. We'll see some of that later, but sometimes it would just be, well, there's a person doing something, but no particular story involved. Part of the development of the technology is, and you remember, I'll bring you back to Clay Shirky. Clay Shirky, in the video we watched at the very beginning of the term, referring to the internet, said, It's not when the technology is shiny and new that we do really interesting things with it. It's when the technology's kind of been around for a while, we stop focusing on the technology itself and start focusing more on what we can do with that technology. And I think if we look at film history, when we look back at old films, we see that early films, the earliest films, they present things that look sort of mundane to us now. They aren't really about telling stories so much as just showing an image of something. And the novelty of being able to show that image in motion was the thing that was of interest when technology was new and technology was just starting out. It took several years into the development of film before people really got into more sophisticated storytelling methods. So, okay, the kinetoscope. The kinetoscope was the first commercially viable film technology. Now, the kinetoscope wasn't it didn't project images on a wall. It was projected an image down into an individual viewer, and you can see on this screen right now. There's a man standing over a cabinet. That cabinet has you see he's looking through a little viewfinder, and what he's seeing in that is there's a spool of individual photos taken of something. And again, persistence of vision. They're individual photos of something that is, they're either something in motion or they're something, photos taken individually and arranged to project, to represent motion. And the way they work, if you've seen, I'll do it here, you've probably all seen at one point or another, when you take a stack of paper, you can draw pictures on the paper and then flip the pages past. And if you look at the pages where the drawings are, you see motion. You see each little image makes each little image with incremental changes starts to look like movement. The kinetoscope was a machine that did exactly that. It projected light onto a series of photos or images, and those images went by on a spool, and they looked and it created an illusion of motion. I'll call your attention to the name of one of the people who developed the kinetoscope, Thomas Edison. We came across Edison previously when we were dealing with sound technologies. Thomas Edison in the late 1800s was involved in many different types of inventions, everything from light bulbs to mechanical objects. He was both an inventor and a business person who was trying to buy up the rights to different inventions. Oftentimes his name is attached to technologies that were perhaps partly his invention, but oftentimes there were things that other people were developing, and Edison made a deal with them and became a partner in a business that was dealing with that invention. Okay, another thing that's interesting about the kinetoscope, the kinetoscope was oftentimes what happened was there would be an exhibition hall, a place where people could go, might be a temporary spot like a carnival, or might be a more permanent entertainment spot, and there would be many individual machines set up. So the kinetoscope is an individual viewing machine. They weren't designed for many people to look at one image. They were designed for one person to look at one series of images at a time. You could go into one of these halls and depending on how they were charging, oftentimes I've seen these when I was growing up. I saw kinetoscopes, and I'm sorry, I didn't grow up in the era that kinetoscopes were current technology, but I have visited places, and I've gone places where kinetoscopes were set up as sort of interesting entertainment, so people could see how early technologies related to film work. There's a place in San Francisco, last place I saw these, that's probably still running. But in any case, so you'd have individual machines, and each machine would have a different set of images in it, and you could go from machine to machine, and oftentimes they were you'd put a coin in to make it operate, or you'd pay an admission fee and get to use however many viewers you wanted to. Okay, so what's important here, the viewing was individual, but it was a group experience. People coming together in the same room and kind of seeing things together. I think culturally, we call this the viewing context. Film is oftentimes, as film developed, it was a communal experience rather than an individual experience like you might find with television, or a family experience like television. The cinematograph. This was French. Now I want to point out here also, film technologies, like other technologies we've looked at, are developing in an international context. There are people from different countries involved with developing film. There were people from Edison from the United States. There were people from Britain. Auguste and Louis Lumière were French. In 1895, they developed something called the cinematograph, and this was a lightweight projector. This was the first commercially viable projection system for film, and it allowed for group viewing of films so that people could come in and sit in a hall, and everybody watched together, watch films together. This is something that changed the viewing experience. People went from a viewing experience. I'm sorry, I don't have a photo of many people watching at the same time, but if you imagine the man on the left viewing individually, imagine in the photo on the right here, many people looking at images in each of these individual cabinets. That's kind of the viewing experience that the kinetoscope provided. We contrast that to the cinematograph, in which the viewing was actually simultaneous. A number of people sitting in a hall watching the same image that's projected in larger size on a screen. Okay, I'd like you now to take a couple of minutes. If you look at our Facebook page, and I'll post the link to the page. I don't know if you can pick it up through our conference, but there's the link to our Facebook page. If you look at our Facebook page, I've posted there. You'll have to scroll down a little bit. Whoops. Why isn't it there? Oh, I know why. Okay. Wait, where is it? Ken, if you're there, I tried to post a link to our Facebook page for a video, and I don't see it showing up when I post it. Any idea what might have happened with that? I've got three videos that I posted today, but I don't see them actually appearing on the page. I wrote there. I see it down in the corner under visitor posts, and unfortunately it doesn't give me the picture to go along with the... Is there something you can do to give me permission to post so that the image of the so that the screenshot from the video shows up so that people know what they're looking at? All right, let me check. No, I don't see it. I refreshed the screen, but I don't see it at the top of the page for some reason. Ah, there. Okay, now I see the great train robbery. The one we're looking for right now, I posted, is Lumiere workers leaving the factory. And then after that, a trip to the moon. Okay, I see a trip to the moon. Now let me post for everybody the link that I have that lets me see these. Okay, so I've just posted the link to the page that I'm looking at that lets me... There. Okay. All right. Sorry for the confusion, everybody. All right. Now, if you take a look now back at our screen, the very first commercial film screening took place in December 1985. I'm sorry, 1895. And this was a screening by the Lumiere brothers. They showed 10 short films at this screening. One of them was a film called Workers Leaving the Lumiere Factory. In other words, they set up a camera outside the factory and they filmed workers leaving. And then when they did their commercial screening, one of the films they showed was this Workers Leaving the Factory. I'd like you please take a look at our Facebook page, and there you'll see a link to a film called Workers Leaving the Lumiere Factory. It's just a couple minutes long. I'd like you to take a moment just to watch that, please. So take, let's see. Yeah, it's 2 minutes long. So please follow the link, set it up, and watch that for a moment. Okay. All right, so I posted this film, really wanted you to have a sense of what early film was like. When the Lumiere brothers did their first commercial screening, it was the technology itself that was the draw. It wasn't what was being shown, or at least not the specific content of what was being shown. It was just the fact of somebody being able to capture some moving images and present them on a screen. And so when we watch this old film, and sure, the content, you know, for us, the content may be interesting because we see people dressed very differently than we see them today. But it's also kind of mundane. It's just people leaving work. They're going. And we see dogs and horses and people leaving. But nothing special. There's no story. There's nothing that engages us and tries to tell us something beyond just, here's some people leaving the factory. And this was a lot of what early film was like. Here's a man with a dog. Here's a girl with a flower. Here's someone in a bathing suit. And a lot of early film was like that, just very everyday situations. It was the possibility of showing moving images itself was the draw, not so much the content of the films. So that was the very earliest kinds of technology. Now there were competing technologies. There was another technology called the Vitascope, which was a motion picture projector. It was first demonstrated by Americans, Charles Francis Jenkins and Thomas Armat in 1895. Thomas Edison bought the rights. Now again, so Edison is not only doing his own inventions, but he's also strategically buying up rights to other people's inventions because he's a business person and an inventor at the same time. And he wants to make his fortune in ensuring that he's on the forefront of whatever technologies are available. So there were competing technologies. The cinematograph was different technology than the Vitascope. In some ways, sometimes the differences between different technologies are very big, and sometimes they're small. A lot of what they had to do with was specific kinds of patents. Okay, so you could have, now, in order for film to run, in order for someone to have an exhibition hall, they had to have a projector. Projector would be expensive. You didn't want to have to buy multiple projectors. So there was competition over whose technology would dominate. And it could be something as simple as, you know, if the technology, you have to have something that runs the film through past a light to project the image at a certain speed. Could be something as simple as what speed does the image run through, how many sprockets per inch, all that kind of thing. So that was the level at which competition over technologies took place. Okay. Another person who was important in the development of early film was Georges Méliès. He was another French entertainer. He was a magician. He was in the business of entertaining people by creating illusions. And he saw a lot of possibilities for film as a storytelling medium in which he could take advantage of that medium to enhance illusions. It was very important. This was a very important step with film. Excuse me just a moment. Because with the Lumiere brothers, workers leaving the factory, you saw what they did was they just set up a camera and people walked by. Occasionally there are places where the film stops and then starts again, but there's no particular reason for the stopping or starting that relates to what we're seeing on the screen. This is different for what Georges Méliès is doing. He's using film as a medium in which you can use editing. You can cut the film at a particular point, stop the action, and then restart it. So he used that editing ability to insert things into the film so that it looks like magic. Okay. Excuse me. I seem to be getting my kid's cold. All right. So I'd like you now to take a look at the Facebook page again. And you'll see posted on there a film called A Trip to the Moon. Whoops, wrong screen. Okay, look for this picture of a moon with a rocket in it, essentially. A Trip to the Moon. I'd like you to watch, let's watch about 5 minutes of this one. It's a bit longer. We don't need to watch the whole thing right now, but please watch the first 5 minutes. Okay, so please watch the first 5 minutes of that, and I'll see you in a moment. As you watch, please try to pay close attention to what you're seeing happen in the screen.
I
Hello, everyone. Are you out there? Whoops, let me look at this. Sorry, something happened and I was disconnected. Let me try to set up the slides again. In the meantime, the last message I was trying to post was please to watch until about the 7.5 minute mark the trip to the moon video. Okay, let's see. I apologize for that interruption. I'm not really sure what happened. It just suddenly wouldn't let me disconnected me and wouldn't let me log in, so I had to reboot everything. Okay, now another thing I'd like to point out about these two films that we've seen so far. You notice the first one, at least on as I was watching, now it may be you may have experienced something different, sometimes that happens, but as I was watching the Lumiere brothers, workers leaving the factory, there was music playing. This was not early film technologies did not include sound along with the film. And most likely, the Lumiere brothers, at the point at which the Lumiere brothers were showing film, it wasn't actually common yet to play music along with the film. This came later because in film exhibition, people started to notice that at first the technology was new and exciting, and you could just watch the film without any sound accompanying it. But pretty soon it became clear that it was more interesting for people to have sound along with the film, because the technology had not developed to the point that that sound could be incorporated into film, because that technology didn't yet exist. Early film exhibition, oftentimes there would be a performance. The exhibition would include a live performance of music. Somebody would play the piano, or they may have somebody to provide voices. Now you notice another thing about the Lumiere brothers, Lumiere brothers, about the trip to the moon is, although there's a story, although there are people interacting, the story is not told with words. In other words, all we see is what's happening on the screen, and we're left to fill in the blanks about what's actually going on. And the story is told in a way, you know, we can kind of see. So there's a group of men dressed like wizards, and they're all excited and jumping up and down. And then I think a thing that's really interesting, it looks like they're all holding telescopes, and they raise up the telescopes, and suddenly the telescopes, poof, become stools that they put down to sit on. So this is one of the examples of the use of editing to perform illusions. Similarly, when you look at when the spaceship gets launched to the moon and the ship lands on the moon, You'll notice there's a break and suddenly, boom, the rocket appears in the eye of the moon. These are the kinds of, these illusions, to us now, they look quite primitive. I mean, anybody with any little camera that can do these kinds of things. When I was in university, I took some film classes, and one of the very first things they taught us was to do was what they call in-camera edits, where all you do is you have your shot running, and then you stop the camera, and then you change whatever it is that you want to change. So you either move the camera to another scene, or you change what's in the image of the screen so that something happens that's changed in front of the viewer. And that's how these illusions were working. There are other examples. This was a technique that Méliès pioneered, and he used a lot in his films. So again, a trip to the moon, by the time storytelling became common with film, usually the viewing context for the film would be one in which there would be some live music, maybe somebody playing speaking roles to help fill out the story for everybody. There may be somebody there telling someone what's happening, or actually acting out the part, providing the voice. And exhibition halls often were left to their own to decide how to do this. There wasn't a great deal of control. The films would be distributed from one exhibition hall to another exhibition hall, and the people who ran the exhibition halls would be responsible for deciding exactly how to present the film. Okay, now another innovation, the Nickelodeon craze. Now remember, I told you that the kinetoscope, the early kinetoscope, you could sometimes put coins in. There was developed in the early 1900s. At least in America, developed what we called the Nickelodeon. Now, this was an exhibition space where people could go and watch movies on kinetoscopes or similar, or Nickelodeons. They were similar technology where you would individually watch. These were often set up in storefronts or places where people would go. If you imagine now, when you go to a shopping center or a mall, there may be restaurants, large stores, video entertainment centers, similar kind of concept, trying to draw in people who may be going somewhere else. But if you have a Nickelodeon, they may see it and say, oh, there's something entertaining. Another thing is early film developed as a cheaper alternative to live theater. So early film was really considered a lower class phenomenon. You notice with the Lumiere brothers, film factory workers. Oftentimes the things that are depicted in early film are actually kind of working class, not exclusively, but oftentimes things that appeal to working class people. And early film was considered lower class, decadent, risky. So it had that kind of a character about it. You know, the people who went to film usually were not wealthy people. They were people who had little bit of money to spend and wanted some entertainment. So, another film, which I'd like you to take a look at, watch the first 5 minutes or so, is The Great Train Robbery. Now, The Great Train Robbery is one of the early, more sophisticated stories. Let's watch the first 5 minutes of this one. It's also posted on our Facebook page. So please watch. Should be posted there. Yes, it is. On my screen, it's the third. Whoops. Ah, there it is. On my screen, it's, yes, the third one down. So please take a few minutes to watch the beginning of The Great Train Robbery.
Thank you.
So you see with the Great Train Robbery, storytelling is getting a little bit more sophisticated fairly quickly, film industry. And I think that this is, it's important to realize the speed at which this storytelling is happening. As the technology evolves, as it becomes familiar to people, people start demanding that the technology do something different, that it tell entertaining stories. A whole industry starts to develop around the telling of film stories and selling these kinds of stories. Now, I've added a clip just now to our Facebook page from a movie called Singing in the Rain. Singing in the Rain is, it's a later film. It's a film that came out in, I think it came out in the late 1930s, early 1940s. It was after, it would have been actually later than that. But this was a film that was commenting on, it was making a commentary on the rise of sound in the film industry. So if you can picture this, it's a film that's set in the 1920s, in the era when film technology started to adopt sound. And at that point, storytelling in film was completely sound free. You didn't have to be able to speak in film, and kind of the joke that's involved in the film has to do with partly with the technology, the inability of the technology to do the things that are being asked of it, and also the inability of performers to do that. Ken, can you get that? Make that clip visible for us that I posted. It's one more film clip that's on our page. Okay, that's not going to load for me. Okay, let's see. There. Okay, instead of taking that time, why don't you just, when you have a chance after class, please take a look at that other clip, which is sort of a commentary on sound, and I'll go on with the slides now. Okay, so in the early motion picture industry, there were a lot of different competitors with slightly different technologies. Many of them, they all had their own patent system. They were all trying to promote their own technologies. And the reason that the adoption of technology was so important is there was a great deal of expense involved in reproducing things. So an exhibition hall, it was a lot of money to buy a projector. So when you bought a projector, you were locked into a particular system economically. You didn't want to have to buy multiple projectors. Right? Similarly, film, reproducing film was an expensive thing. The way that films would be distributed, the film company would make multiple copies and then distribute them from one theater to the next theater to the next theater. It wasn't at all cheap to reproduce. So there was an economic need, an economic incentive to have to be the dominant technology. There were the 10 largest companies, included Edison, Biograph, Vitagraph, and others. They formed a group called the Motion Picture Patents Company, MPPC. This was a trade group, and basically what they did was they set an agreement to standardize the industry. So among all these companies, they said, all right, if we're going to have this industry, if we work together, the 10 largest companies work together, it can benefit us. What they were trying to do was actually to take advantage of the size of the largest companies and squeeze out other competitors, so squeeze out the market share for independent companies. And they did things like they started putting together exclusive contracts to get the best technology. So for instance, if you recognize the name Eastman Kodak, Eastman Kodak was one of the very big photographic companies in this era, and continued to be a big photographic company. So the MPPC developed an exclusive contract with them in order to squeeze out competition. So very important to recognize a very common pattern with developing technologies is the attempt to establish a technology and then establish agreements with companies in order to secure your position as a dominant player. Feature film. Now, the early films were on short reels. About 12 minutes was as long as a reel could hold for early film, films were shown generally just one reel at a time. There weren't generally long stories with early film. But as the demand for more sophisticated storytelling developed, there came innovations to use multiple reels to tell stories. Oftentimes how this would work is you would have a film set up. Sometimes people would do things where they would actually string reels together so that you'd have two reels of film and they'd attach to one another and go through. But more frequently what would happen is you'd have two projectors set up side by side. And I worked in a projection studio years ago where we did this. You'd have two projectors set up side by side, where the images would be shown one on top of the other. So the image for each projector would project in the exact same place, and the person working the projector there would know where one strip of film ended and the other began, and so you'd watch. You'd know where the change point came up, and you'd watch and watch and watch, and then when the one reel was coming to the end, you'd turn on the second reel, and the story would continue in uninterrupted. Another thing that was done for multiple reel storytelling was what's called the intermission, where you'd show the film until the point at which the reel ended, and when the reel ended, you'd tell everybody, okay, intermission, take a break while we set up the next reel. So longer stories meant that more sophisticated stories could be told. this made film a bit more of a competitor for the audience that was going to live theater. A live theater play, you know, maybe a couple of hours long. As film was able to tell longer stories, tell more sophisticated stories, the respectability of film as a medium went up, and this helped. This really helped usher in what we call the star system, where we have recognized actors appearing in film, and people would start paying attention to who the actors were and become fans of particular actors. Film started to become more of a higher culture medium rather than just a low culture medium. Hollywood, you know, I think most everybody in the world now knows the name Hollywood and associates it with film. In recent years, there's been bigger recognition of other places as well. But Hollywood became big in the early film industry in the United States was actually mostly located around New York. As the film industry developed, there were a few reasons that Hollywood started to become a dominant location for film production. One was just the weather. Right? The early film industry did not have the advantage of good lighting, and so it was important in order to film, people often need a nice sunny day. And you don't necessarily get a lot of nice sunny days in New Jersey and New York. You do in Southern California, and that was one of the draws of Hollywood. So another draw of that area was lots of varied scenery. You could have access to ocean, to mountains, to deserts. So that area of the United States is one that offers lots of different kinds of scenery, which allowed for creating lots of different, a sense of different places in movie making. Land was cheap in the early 1900s in Southern California, and by moving west, the people that were involved in developing the motion picture industry were able to pull away from the influence of some of the people who were dominant in other industries like radio, and become more influential in this developing industry than they may have been otherwise. We've talked in terms of, industry self-regulation. One of the things that happens with many communication industries is people become concerned sometimes about certain aspects of new communication technologies. What influence are they having on us? What are they doing to our morals? These sorts of things. The film industry is a very good example of an industry that for which society people became concerned about the content of films, about the moral character of people in the industry, so on and so forth. As a response to some of these concerns, and there were a number of scandals involved that involved the film industry. In the 1920s and 1930s. As a response to some of the concerns, there was a group formed called the Motion Picture Producers and Distributors of America, later called the Motion Picture Association of America. What this group did was it created a set of rules for the industry made by the industry itself, sort of self-governance, that that addressed what kind of content you could have in films. They created something in 1930 called the motion the Hollywood Production Code, which was a set of rules about what could be shown. And for example, the production code. Now, one of the concerns about content was you saw in the Great Train Robbery a story about thievery, robbery. People like stories. Many people, they like stories about action and adventure, and crime stories are very big. And one of the problems that that government was beginning to discuss in the 1920s was the tendency in the film industry to tell stories about gangsters and to kind of glamorize the gangster life. So the industry, in response to these concerns, one of the things that the industry did with the Hollywood Production Code was to say, it didn't say you couldn't have stories about crime and gangsters and things like that. They didn't want to rule those out because they were very popular. But what they did was they said, if you have a story about a gangster, about crime, you should always show that the criminals get punished. So in the end of these gangster stories, after the production code comes in, at the end of the movie, the gangster always goes to jail or gets killed or something else happens to show, you know, this life may be glamorous, but there's punishment involved. And this was one of the ways the production code set rules that said, if you're showing something that's morally questionable, you have to show that there's some punishment involved, or some negative outcome for the person that's involved in this. In 1968, Hollywood developed the ratings system, and there are now different rating systems in different industries that are developed off this, but it was essentially a set of guidelines about what films were appropriate for what ages. It sort of recognized that there are films that are acceptable for any audience. But there are some films that require some maturity and only adults should see them. So that's what the rating system first came in 1968. Okay, so the production code, it's also called the Hays Code after the person who was responsible for pushing it through the industry. So general principles. No picture shall be produced that will lower the moral standards of those who see it. Hence, the sympathy of the audience should never be thrown to the side of crime, wrongdoing, evil, or sin. In other words, if you show something sinful, you have to show that it's bad, show that it gets punished. Correct standards of life, subject only to the requirements of drama and entertainment, shall be presented. So uphold moral standards. Law, natural or human, shall not be ridiculed, nor shall sympathy be created for its violation. Excuse me. So those are the kinds of things that they go into the production code. Okay. We've run out of time, at least for my time. Excuse me, my voice is also going. So I'm going to stop here. I'm going to pick up next week. So we're going to pick up with sound, the development of sound. I apologize for not getting all the way through the chapter, but we'll pick it up. We'll pick it up next week. I hope you all have a good week. Please do take a look at that clip, and I'll probably post a couple of other clips in the meantime, and then send out a message to alert you to it. So please have a good week, and I look forward to being in touch with you next week. Please take a 10-minute break here, and then Ken will take over. Thank you.
Sometimes stop at this problem because internet bad.
Okay, so as you see, my image is a little bit different here today because I'm on a different computer, and let's see if, Anyway, we'll go ahead with the student presentations. So, Viola will go ahead and present first, and then Dayun. So, it looks like the PowerPoint is all set up, so I'll turn off the mic and let Viola take over. While apparently she must be rebooting or something, okay. First off, can you hear me now? If not, I'll get a microphone. Okay. Well, I turned up my mic, so that's good. Okay. Well, we'll get once Viola is ready to get started again. I need to, I guess, give her moderator powers again. So, okay, so Viola now has moderator powers again, so she can reload her PowerPoint and get started. While the PowerPoint is being reloaded, I'll just make a few comments kind of in advance, something I was going to talk about previously. You know, a lot of times as we get into new innovations and especially in the area of entertainment, there are concerns about who, you know, or the impact of the new entertainment on society. And I have to confess, I have a prejudice when it comes to games. When my son was young, I bought him a computer, or bought a computer for the children, but put it in his room, so he kind of felt possessive of it. And he began playing lots of games on the computer. And I didn't worry too much about it. At first, I was playing games with him, and we enjoyed that together. Later, he kind of, you know, started doing it more on his own with his friends and spent more time with it. I still didn't worry too much about it. Then he graduated from high school and went to the university. Well, let me back up a little bit. Even in the high school, he frequently, he was very smart. He got really good scores on nationalized tests, but he frequently didn't bother to hand in his homework. I didn't really tie that too much to his game playing. I probably should have, but I didn't think too much about that. And then when he got to university, his first semester at the university, he got straight A's, everything top grades in all of his courses. And then in his second semester, he flunked out, basically. He got, I don't know if he got all F's, but very, very low grades in his second semester. And much of his life, he's now nearly 40 years old, and much of his life has been kind of dominated by, he doesn't drink alcohol, he doesn't smoke, he doesn't have those kinds of vices, but his whole life is kind of centered around entertainment and particularly games. And he's kind of getting out of that right now as an adult. He's you know, getting married and has some stepchildren, is about to have his own for his first child. And so I think he's kind of growing out of that, but it's taken a long time to kind of get out of the phase of you know, entertainment first, so to speak. And so consequently, I hate games. That's my bias. I have to admit, I hate electronic games just because of what I saw, you know, my son going through. And I, truthfully, if he hadn't gotten into games, he might have gotten into something else that maybe even worse. Who knows? You know, just a lot of his life, it just seemed like slipped by without him accomplishing a lot because of his love for games. And so that's my bias. And I know, you know, as I mentioned, when the movies came out, people worried about the influence of movies, when, you know, all this sort of stuff. A lot of people are still worried about social media, and we're going to get isolated because of social media. Although my experience with social media is that it actually helps me. It enhances my real social experience. Puts me back into contact with people I hadn't talked to for decades. helps me to continue my relationship with my students. And there's, I see lots of advantages to social media, not to say there aren't some negative advantages, but so I know, you know, people get upset and concerned about lots of different things. My concern, you know, my greatest concern with the new technologies is kind of the addictive nature that games can have on some people. Not everybody, but on some people. So I don't ever play games anymore. Once I saw, you know, my son getting into them too much, I would never play a game again. You couldn't pay me enough to play an online or a computer game anymore. So that's my bias. Okay, looks like Viola's ready to take off, so I will turn off my speech and let her take over.
Okay, hello. Can you hear me? Okay, hello everyone, good afternoon. And today I'd like to have my presentation about electric games and entertainment. The first part is about the evolution of the electronic games. The first coin-operated aircraft games was modeled on Space War. It was called Computer Space, and it fared poorly among the general public because of its different controls. The first video games console for the home beginning selling in 1972. It was the Maclopux Odyssey, and it was based on the prototypes built by Raphael Baer in the late 1960s. The birth of the home computer market in the 1970s correlated and emergency of the video games consoles. In the time before the personal computer, early video games allowed to the general public to access technology that had been restricted to the realm of the abstract science. Talents for two created an interface where anyone can basic motor skills could use a complex machine. The first video games functioned early on as a form of medium by instantly dismissing of the appearance of the computer technology to those without access to it. The 1980s, Nintendo, a Japanese card, the picture, like the picture, a Japanese card and lofty producer that had began to produce electronic games in the 1970s was responsible for aircraft games such as the Donkey Kong in the early 1980s. Other software companies were still interested in the home console market in the mid-1980s. Video games researched Wilder Eddie Essence in the 1980s with the advent of the first-person shooter genre and population-long occasion games such as Myst. The games were marketed to the older adolescents and their success increased the demand of the similar games. The 1990s, the repeat evolution of the video games. A major advance in game technology came with the increase in internet use by the general public in the 1990s. The development of the portable game system was another important aspect of the video games during in the 1990s. online capability that development in the 1990s and expand in the 2000s allowed players to compete in teams. The innovation attracted larger audiences to grant and lead to the new means of the social communication. And the early 2000s, 21st century games, a new generation of Facebook, family-oriented games in the late 2000s, included families to interact through video games. The games also brought in the older demographics that have never used video games before. The second part is about the inflationary contemporary games. First one is about the Guitar Hero and the Rock Band. Guitar Hero and Rock Band created a new means of the marketing for the music industry. Music featured on the games experienced increased downloads and for sales. And the Grand Theft Auto series was a revolution and a controversial for its open end field. Players could choose a number of different options, allow them to set their own goals and create their own version of the game. The Call of the Beauty series of the first person shooter games in the table for its recording breaking success in the video games market, creating more than $3 billion in the return sales through late 2009, and World of the Warcraft. The World of the Warcraft that brought the MMORPG genre to the new height of the popularity, and the large number of the user has made the game evolve to level and complexity ahead of the video games. The last is about Wii Sports and Wii Fit. Wii Sports and Wii Fit brought video games to audiences that they have never been talked by game maker. All the adults and the families used Wii Sports as a means of the family bonding, and Wii Fit took advantage of the motion-controlled game playing to enter the 15 markets. The second part is about the impact of the video games on culture. SSD keys and the predictor of the gaming culture have had an increased effect on the mainstream culture. This has led to the general acceptance of the marginal things, social groups, and increased comfort with the visual world and the pursuit of the new means of the interaction. The effect of the video games on the larger type of media. Video games have gone from being a directive medium that look it cute from a larger media such as book, films, and music, to being a form of the media that larger types develop a new ideas from. Video games have also incorporated with other forms of the media to change them and create new means of the entertainment and the interaction. Educational instruction has embraced the use of the video games are wearable tools for teaching. We can see the picture is not clearly, but we can see that they have the line 95% that of the teachers use the digital games. Help the people, help the student to study and to the educational use. Their totals include the simulated words in which important like the skills can be learned and improved. The last part is about the video games as art. Will video games maybe not be accepted by everyone as a form of art? There is no doubt that they contribute greatly to artist media such as the music and the film. For the it's about the issues. The first one is violence. Video games violence has been an issue since the 1976 game Death Race. The pertinence of the video games to the simulated media create a new issue in the entertainment media. A great number of the new stories link video games with violent crimes. Studies have been found a correct connection between assessing behavior and video games. But collecting crime and these studies do not prove that the video games cause the violent acts. The video games rating system informed procedure about the content of the game. The highest rating are the only hard video game sales, so companies try to make games that they rate mature. Critics charge the video games rating as inconsistent with other stimulants, such as the movie rating system. Video games addiction is associated more with the online games, also mainly in system of the single players of sensing of things, except as well. It has become a high profile issue with the rise of the popularity of the online gaming. The American Medical Association has not developed a diagnosis for video games addiction. Instead, it used the term video games overuse to describe the state where an individual of the game habits to have the determinational effect on the his or her personal life. The last issue is about the sexism and the gender issues, a hot topic in the video games industry. As female gamers and developers often struggle for equal footing. Controversy has arisen over the character stereotypes. However, modern games are beginning to break through the conversational barriers of the gender. Okay, the last part is about the blurring boundary between the video games information and entertainment. Team-oriented video games have been allowed a new group to learn skills similar to those learned in the physical sports. Team building, compilation and program slowing and one of the major content of the playing aware teams. Real words, still not video games in themselves, use the design and the perspectives of the video games to create new social space. The space are being used to create new social profiles and the new ways of the communication complex ideas. Video games have been added to the social networking sites to expand the ways in which people can communicate with each other. The medium of the game allows players to interact with their friends in new ways. Okay, the last part is a quiz. Question one, choose the correct answer. The first video game console for the home beginning sitting in. The answer is B, in 1972. The question two is choose the correct description. A, the birth of the home computer market in the 1980s is wrong, but because it's in the 1970s. B is a work of the Warcraft released in the 2009. It's wrong because it's released in the 2004. C is right, it's correct. Video games have development in complexity and flexibility to the point that they are providing new kinds of the social interactions. Nintendo is not a Korean card, it is a Japanese card, the game. Three questions, explain how the world of Warcraft expand the video games as a form of the video. In my opinion, online games such as the World of the Warcraft system, villains, painting, and motivations. It has many players. Gaming motivations revolved that MMORPGs allowed players to achieve game's goal, be social, and immerse in the game. Various words such as the Second Life as good example of their thin line between games and social media. In this various words, user correct over start to respond themselves. Themselves, they can then explore the world and take a part in the culture and creativity that the social factor is composed of the scrolling, including chatting and making new friends in the game. From the new forming a new relationships and working in the team. Research suggests that a social development in the MMORPGs is particularly important for games because it's an intelligent content of the enjoyment of playing. So it's just my opinion. So my creation is, thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Viola. I appreciate your presentation, and maybe I'll add a few more comments and maybe ask a few questions while Dayun loads the next presentation. So go ahead and load the next presentation. Just a couple of thoughts again on the game chapter. I talked about what I perceived to be one of the negatives of gaming. Viola mentioned some positives, and as an educator, I've been working with computer-based curriculum for, I don't know, since 1994, so you know, over 20 years, and the best curricula that I found was actually the first one I ran into way back 22 years ago, and it was did have a lot of game aspect to it. They spent a lot of money. A company called Jostens spent about $80 million creating this this curriculum, and it was very good, very, very effective, and they were, like I said, a lot of game aspects to it. And so I know in education it can be extremely effective. Also, it's increasingly used in marketing. A company can create a game, kind of blend in some aspect of their brand, you might say, and then of course they hope they get addicted. They want people to get addicted on the game and share it with their friends and spend lots of time on it, because every time they begin to use that game, they're exposed to their brand somehow in a positive way. So gamification of marketing is also, I'm not necessarily saying it's a good thing, but it is something that's happening and of value to organizations that do it. So there's some positive aspects of games, I have to admit. Some other, Viola also mentioned some other negatives. For example, violence. Some former soldiers, American soldiers, have said that basically the American military uses games to, what they say, desensitize soldiers. So in other words, a soldier, if they play games where they're killing people, then it won't be so hard when they actually go to battle to kill somebody. And so the military purposefully involves them in games so that their conscience is a little bit seared, and a little bit it becomes much easier to actually kill somebody. So some people have raised questions of, well, if that's true for the military, why is it, would it not be true for gangs or for other criminals or even somebody who gets suicidal? We call sometimes postal, somebody gets fired and they go back and start killing people in their company. If the military uses games to desensitize soldiers to violence, doesn't it have the same effect on other people? I think that's a serious question. It is very difficult to prove that violence, you know, has a major impact on society, that violence in videos and games and so forth have a strong, because it's not usually, it doesn't affect everybody the same way. You know, most of us, if we play a violent game or we watch a movie, a violent movie, we don't go out and kill anybody. So statistically, the people that are affected by violent games or violent movies are in a very small portion. And some psychologists say that if people who have violent tendencies get to exercise that in games or watch movies, then they're maybe even less likely to actually commit a violent act. So there are arguments and counterarguments to that. I tend to think it does affect quite a few people, and that is part of one of the negatives. But like I said, it's impossible. It's very, very difficult to prove that it's a major problem in society, because the actual impact on individuals, even though some of them will say, you know, this game influenced me, or it appears that they're acting out a game, the proportion of people that claim to be affected that way or that we see are affected that way is really low. So, okay, well, I'll turn the time then over to Dayun, who has the next presentation, Internet and Social Media.
Everyone, what I'm going to talk about today is Chapter 11, the Internet and Social Media. Nowadays, almost everyone has more than one account at social network sites like Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. So I'm going to talk about a little of history of social media. I'm sure you guys use the Internet every day. The Internet shapes everything. From our day-to-day routine, like the ability to read newspapers from around the world, to the way research and collaboration are conducted. There are three important aspects of communication that the Internet has changed. The speed of information, the volume of information, and the ability of anyone to publish ideas on the web. The Internet's largest and most revolutionary change has come about through social networking. Because of Facebook, we can find people we haven't talked to for decades, or without making a single awkward telephone call, and because of Twitter, we can now see what our friends are doing in real time. In 1975, a former DARPA scientist named Larry Roberts founded the company Telnet, the first commercial packet switching company. 2 years later, the invention of the dial up modem made it possible for anyone around the world to access the Internet. One of the consequences of the spread of the Internet to Harvest was the founding of Usenet. In 1975, University of North Carolina graduate students connected three computers in a small network and used a series of programming scripts to post and receive messages. Anyone could post a topic or reply on Usenet. But it constrained users to a relatively small pool of resources. This is the picture of Usenet. It seems weird, but because of Usenet, the supply of computers increased. As many news groups emerged in Usenet, it became an important Internet community culture's cornerstone. Also, lots of companies started to set Usenet to use it commercially. AOL in US, Hytale, Chollian, and Naonuri have emerged in Korea. In 1995, the president and founder of Beverly Hills Internet, David Bonnet, announced that the name of his company is now GeoCities. GeoCities built its business by allowing users to create web pages in communities for free, with the stipulation that the company placed a small advertising banner at the top of its page. Anyone could register a GeoCities site and subsequently build a web page about a topic. GeoCities model was so successful that the company Yahoo bought it at its peak in 1999. At the time, GeoCities was the third most visited site on the web, so it seemed like a sure bet. But on October 26, 2009, Yahoo closed GeoCities for good in every country except Japan. Social networking services like Facebook, Twitter, and MySpace provide a limited but public platform for users to create a profile. I chose three social networking services, which are MySpace, Twitter, and Blog. First of all, MySpace allows users to blog, customize color schemes, add background images, and play music. It is particularly targeted toward younger users, but it was overrun with corporate marketing and solicitations for pornographic websites, leading many users to abandon the service. As the internet technology evolves rapidly, most users have few qualms about moving to whichever site offers the better experience. Most users have profiles and accounts on many services at once. But as relational networks become more established and concentrate on a few social media sites, it becomes increasingly difficult for newcomers and lagging challengers to offer the same rich networking experience. Second, Twitter offers a different approach to social networking, allowing users to tweet 140 characters messages to their followers, making it something of a hybrid of instant messaging and blogging. Twitter is openly searchable, meaning that anyone can visit the site and quickly find out what other Twitter users are saying about any subject. Twitter has been useful for journalists reporting on breaking news, as well as highlighting the best of the internet and for marketers looking for a free public forum to disseminate marketing messages. At last, blogs are a public version of a diary or journal. It began as an online. These sites give anyone a platform to write about anything they want to. Posting tweets on the Twitter service is considered microblogging because of the short length of the post. Let's move on to the viral marketing. Media that is spread from person to person, then for example, a friend sends you a link saying you've got to see this, is said to have gone viral. Marketing and advertising agencies have deemed advertising that makes use of this phenomenon as viral marketing. Do you guys know who he is? He is a Korean singer named Psy. When his music video for his song, Gangnam Style, was uploaded on YouTube, the video quickly became a viral sensation and he became a famous singer in the world. As you can see, when viral marketing is successful, it can reach millions of people for many little money and can even make it into the mainstream news. However, it is unpredictable and liable to spend remixes, spin-offs, and spoofs that can dilute or damage the messages that marketers intend to spread. Next, let's see the benefits and problems of social media. First, social media allows an unprecedented volume of personal, informal communication in real time from anywhere in the world. It allows users to keep in touch with friends on other continents, yet keeps the conversation as casual as a Facebook word post. In addition, blogs allow us to gauge a wide variety of opinions and have given breaking news a whole new meaning. Second, news can be distributed through many major outlets instantaneously, and different perspectives on any one event can be aired concurrently. Third, social networks can provide a place for people with more obscure interests to meet one another and share commonalities. Finally, marketing through social media is completely free, making it a valuable tool for small businesses with tight marketing budgets. In the benefits of social media, you need to know what crowdsourcing is. Crowdsourcing is the process of obtaining needed services, ideas, or content by soliciting contributions from a large group of people, and especially from an online community. News organizations can harness bloggers as source of real-time news, in effect outsourcing some of their news gathering efforts to bystander on the scene. In other words, this practice of harnessing the efforts of several individuals online to solve a problem is known as crowdsourcing. Next is the problems of social media. Now, journalists are expected to blog or tweet every story and file reports with little or no analysis, often without adequate time to confirm the reliability of their sources. For example, Twitter presents a similar problem. Instead of getting news from a specific newspaper, many people simply read the articles that are linked from a Twitter feed. As a result, the news cycle leaves journalists no time for analysis or cross-examination. Additionally, news aggregators like Google News profit from linking to journalist stories and major newspapers and selling advertising, but these profits are not shared with the news organizations and journalists who create the stories. Commentators like Kim worry that this trend will lead to young people's inability to distinguish credible information from a mass of sources, eventually leading to a sharp decrease in credible sources of information. Also, the time spent on social networking sites can destroy the social skills of young people. The last downside of social media is that users tend to be exposed only to information they are interested in and opinions they agree with. This lack of exposure to novel ideas and contrary opinions can create or reinforce a lack of understanding among people with different beliefs and make political and social compromise more difficult to combine. Social networking is a double-edged sword like other things. Therefore, I think we should use social networking services wisely. I prepared three questions. Number one, marketing techniques that use pre-existing social networking services, which is the answer is B, viral marketing. Number two, the process of obtaining media services and ideas from an online community. It's called A, crowdsourcing. The last question, the company Yahoo bought something model at its peak in 1999. This company was B, GeoCities. That's the end of my question. Thank you for listening.
Okay, thank you, Dayun. Very good. We're close to running out of time. I did have one thought in my mind I wanted to share, and probably next week we'll see Frederick will try to combine these two chapters into one to try to get caught up. Although I think they may have been combined in the regular syllabus, so he needs to start combining some chapters, or we're just going to run out of time. But just one of the slides that Dayun shared kind of struck me a little bit. It said that there's that social media and some of the things going on in the internet are reducing the exposure to novel ideas and contrary ideas, I guess you could say. On the first, I'm not sure that's true. Maybe in some ways, in some fields, but I think all of us, at least I very frequently see and pass on to my social media network like new inventions or new ideas in the science area. Very, very frequently, like just yesterday, there was some guy who had created a bicycle that floats in the air. Basically, it has big fans in the front and back, and so it's not really a bicycle, but it looks like a bicycle, but it floats. It floats in the air just a foot or two off the ground. And I think yesterday there was another thing. I think every day I share with my social network some new idea, scientific idea, or other new service, new products that are being developed. And so I think in some cases there are a number of companies that are able to start up and get a foothold in the economy because they have access to social media. we know the kind, the idea of viralization, how on, you know, that on social media can happen, and also, well, I guess people consider YouTube social media too. Somebody asked me the other day, is YouTube a social media, more of a social medium or a video platform? And that's a hard question to answer. It's really both, but there's not as much interchange of ideas or dialogue discussion on YouTube as there are, as there is on Facebook, for example. And so I kind of lean towards the edge, the idea that it's more of a video platform than a social medium. However, on the other hand, my argument against myself, I argue both directions, is how videos on YouTube can become viral. And they only become viral because they're socialized, because people start sharing them. People are, you know, fascinated by a video. They're excited by it. They're angered by it. They're amazed by it. And they begin sharing it with their friends. So that sharing activity on YouTube makes it social. However, it also at the same time, the YouTube interacts with Facebook and other social media too. And so it may be we see a video on YouTube, but then we share it actually on Facebook. So the argument of whether it's more social medium than video platform is not really that pertinent. However, it does, again, come back to the question, do social media somehow harm the spread of novel ideas? And I would say to the contrary. I think it more helps it than harms it. That's my opinion. On the other hand, the idea of contrary political ideas or those sorts of ideas, controversial ideas. There is a problem. There's two theories. Frederick has shared with you a number of different theories, and I think in the past have shared a couple of ideas as well, and I might reemphasize here. One is the idea of cognitive dissonance, and that means to say that we don't like to challenge our conceptual framework in our mind. When we think we understand the world, we don't want somebody coming along and saying, "No, you don't understand the world. You can't explain this or that." And so our minds kind of resist having somebody challenge its version of reality, and that's called cognitive dissonance. And so that sometimes entices us to avoid any sources that will challenge our thinking. Well, you put that in the social medium, and some people only develop a social network with those who agree with them. So if they're politically inclined, their network is mostly people who agree with their politics, or economically inclined, those who agree with their economic philosophies. If they're religiously inclined, only with those who agree with them religiously. So people can create their own community of people who only agree with them. Now, in that sense, it does both inhibit the spread of new ideas and more specifically inhibits the people from being exposed to different ideas in politics, economics, religion, whatever it might be, because we ourselves are doing that. Now, I myself, well, I would say more than half of my, well, I'm not even sure about that. I have a very varied social network because I have a lot of friends and who are professors. Professors tend to be, in the American concept of conservative and liberal, tend to be liberal. On the other hand, I have a lot of friends that I do think a lot alike in politics, and so they kind of, I sometimes share their ideas with politics, and I sometimes get into arguments with my liberal professor friends. My students are somewhere in between. Some are conservative, some are liberal. Some are don't care. They're young. They don't care about politics at all yet. And so I think it's possible. And in my case, I do expose myself to a lot of different ideas. I have a website where I have RSS feeds. I think I talked about this before, where basically I have news feeds coming in from conservative news media in America and also Great Britain. And I have news feeds coming in from liberal sources because I want to see what each side is saying. I get email summaries from Huffington Post, which is a liberal news source in America. I just posted one of theirs today, one of their stories. And I get news feeds via email and on Facebook from conservative sources. So I try to expose myself, but that's a matter of choice. And not everybody makes that choice. And so social media and the internet in general can allow you to isolate yourself. And then the other theory I was going to talk about, and then I'll let you go, is groupthink. If you create for yourself a group that only agrees with you, then it can kind of maybe not radicalize you, but it can polarize you because you tend to think, all my friends think like I do. All the people that I respect think like I do. Therefore, anybody who is smart thinks like I do. Because you've kind of cut off your exposure to those people with which you disagree. And so you don't see that there's actually a balance. That there are very smart people who are conservative and very smart people who are liberal and very smart people in the middle because you're exposing yourself to those that agree with you. And so groupthink can cause you to polarize yourself from other people that disagree with you. And I think that's happened a lot in America. I think it's happening some in other countries as well. I don't know to what extent. I'm not an expert in that. But in America, we see in the presidential election, the Republicans hate the Democrats. The Democrats hate the Republicans. The people in the middle are kind of sick of their fighting each other, but they also start getting pulled one direction or the other. Our political system is becoming much, much more polarized than it was when I was younger. You can't be a Republican and be friendly to a Democrat anymore, it seems like. I mean, obviously, it's not universal, but it's more difficult for a conservative to be friends with a liberal. Like I say, I make a point to. I have liberal friends, and I have conservative friends. So, but there are a lot of people who don't. And so social media allows them to avoid such contact. So it can be a very negative thing. So I do both agree and disagree depending in the area of innovation, of scientific innovation and new inventions. I think we see that social media and can be a very positive thing. And those things can spread without a big advertising budget. But in the area of politics and stuff, it can be very isolating because we choose it to be. We don't want, because of cognitive dissonance, we don't want our ideas challenged. And so we expose ourselves only to those people with whom we agree. And that's one of the possibilities. Okay, we're out of time. Thank you. And we will see you again next week. I don't have the list in front of me of who's presenting, but please be prepared. Also, your next creative project is, I can't remember whether it's due today or next week, but please get that going. Okay, thank you. When people, it's nice to know when people are going to be missing, and we'll, work around that. And I will post the videos so that those that miss the class can watch the video version. Okay, have a great day. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.